Thunder. Thunder. Thunder! Thunder Geeks are live. Hello, Thundarians. You're listening to 102.7 FM CIL.
Phew.
Around the world at luradio.ca or streaming video live at facebook.com/thundergeekspeak. That was I Fight Dragons with Punch Drunk Destiny, and I'm Andrew.
I'm Rob.
I'm Megan.
And Evka.
And we're your Thunder Geeks. Welcome again to another very special episode. Of course, if this is your first time tuning in, hi, we're your Thunder Geeks. Each week we like to get together, talk about the nerdy stuff we've been up to this week, what's going on in our community, and just try to make you laugh for an hour and a half.
I just had a weird thought. We're like a few hundred... I said weird, not good. There's a difference. We're a few hundred episodes in.
Yes.
Can you imagine someone trying to keep continuity here?
Yeah, through 256 episodes? I think that's doable.
With us?
I have always told the truth.
I'm really inconsistent, so continuity would be really, really hard with me, I think. I don't know.
What are we talking about? I'm not sure Rob understands the word he's using. Continuity. Do you understand continuity in the way that Rob's... I understand continuity in the way that
I'm referring to a
consistent
story. Yeah, we're telling our story, and trust me...
But we're alive.
That doesn't mean we don't have a story. Because I've been editing these things. There is weirdly a narrative going on that you haven't noticed. You have to listen to all the episodes in order.
Splice it into, like, one random story.
There's a narrative.
There's a secret narrative going on here.
Chaos. Okay, where's your cork board and your strings?
If you're my secret Santa, please get me those, and I will totally show you the secret narrative of Thunder Geeks.
So we had a bet earlier. Let's talk about that really
bet.
Quick.
Bet.
Oh, sure, when it's not you, you're all into it, but when it's you, bet. It's like, I have to make a bet.
Because I don't take chances
it's
like that.
Better to watch.
But Megan, if we've learned anything from the magic school bus, we have to take chances, make mistakes, and get messy.
I don't want to, not with Rob anyway. None of those things. Not with Rob.
Hey.
We've taken lots of chances with Rob, and sometimes they turn out fantastic.
Sometimes
there's a scary guy that...
this again.
We'll stop beating that dead horse. But the bet. So, Rob is confident he's figured out everyone's secret Santa. And he thinks... Specifically me. And Rob thinks that I have him for secret Santa. And I just want to see how confident Rob was, so I'll bet me on it.
And we'll do a radio-friendly bet of the loser has to read some the winner says.
So, I am definitely going to win here.
Sure you are.
Kyle, do you think Rob's going into like a kamikaze mission right now? Is he trying to lose?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You really want to read radio-friendly erotica, don't you?
Hey, as... That's the key thing. As long as it's radio-friendly, I'm game.
There's a point in the office where Kevin's like, if anyone ever offers you 10,000 to one, take it. It's Rob going in right now. He's just like...
Yeah. Because I'm...
Have a bet. Going in, I'm going to take it.
Well, yeah, because a 10,000 to one bet is if I put a dollar on it, I win $10,000.
Oh, you know what would be really funny? If we accidentally screwed up the list... And then no one has Rob for Secret Santa.
I'd be very sad because I put a lot
and
of
still
thought
wrong.
And heart. I put a lot of thought and heart into my gift for mine. So yeah.
I always just think about what someone could use or need, and then I apply that to said present or gift or stuff.
See, I like to take one characteristic about someone. And supersize it to comedic levels. When I'm getting a gift, that is it.
Rob, you take a stereotype of a person and then just make a caricature of it?
Yes, one year when I got Megan, I got her the giant eraser and giant pencil. Because art. But I supersized it.
Actually, no, that was kind of genius.
See, that's what I do. I'll take I'll choose a characteristic about you guys and go, big.
big nuggets.
At what point does it transfer from a nugget to a patty?
What?
Or yeah, because it's a chicken nugget at one size, but then it's like just a chicken breast.
There's a chicken tender in there too, which is
like
elongated.
I take chicken tenders as unprocessed.
What?
No, chicken tenders are always longer than chicken nuggets.
Long chicken nuggets.
Actually, you know what? You're right.
So nugget tender.
Okay, nugget
patty?
Tender.
Patty. A whole rotisserie chicken.
Well, that's like the end game.
That's it.
So okay, Kyle, if I got you, you just get a full.
But the thing is that
I wouldn't mind
tender is defined by its longness. But the difference between a nugget and a patty, at one point does it stop being a nugget and expand into a patty? Because a tender is defined by its shape more than its size.
I'm gonna say a nugget becomes a patty when you need less than two nuggets for a bun. So two nuggets or more is nuggets. Because if it's a patty, you're putting it between buns for like a chicken sandwich.
What if you get a very small bun?
Like it's a slider. Like
yeah,
hold on.
Does the chicken burger
from A&W count as just a chicken nugget sandwich?
Yes.
No, that is distinctly a patty, but I think you can even go smaller. You can change a nugget into a patty. I can take a McNugget and make a bun small enough to put a round said nugget, and it is a chicken sandwich. Structurally and physically, it is the same as any chicken sandwich. Are nuggets different from patties?
Yes.
Why? Where? When do they become different? When is a nugget not a patty?
I don't have an argument for this, but all I know is that I really, really like chicken nuggets. And now I'm thinking about that.
But now you can have, like,
nuggy
giant
science
hand
is something that we need to explore here.
Okay, so if Rob, by Rob's, like, understanding of how he gifts, we have to take something about someone and to make it extraordinarily, like, over the top, right?
Yes.
So, Rob, if I was to get you for Secret Santa, you're getting a migraine for Christmas.
That's called a concussion.
I thought Kyle's the only one here who gets concussions.
Megan's just gonna hit you with the car again. I wanted to bring back old memories.
I can't even drive. I would just be like, oops, oops, oops. That's like three times. Whoopsie doodle. It's like Mole Man driving.
Well, it'll definitely be a secret. It's like right before we enter the studio, Megan just steals my car. Merry Christmas, jerk!
Merry Christmas, everyone!
So I've honestly been trying to Google when does a nugget become a patty? Or a definition of nugget.
Is this a conversation the internet has had before?
A small, usually rounded piece of food.
But small is also subjective. Like, have you ever seen that picture of Andre the Giant holding a regular beer can?
Yes!
It looks like an itty-bitty thing. So for him, even a chicken patty would be like a nugget to the guy.
My instinct was to go bite-size. When it's no longer bite-size, it's no longer a nugget. However, there are people with large mouths.
Hum!
There's got to be someone out there that can, you know, take a whole McChicken patty in one mouth.
Well, I mean...
Oh, I can.
Yeah.
Here's the thing.
Of course, Rob.
I haven't done
Rob
it with...
not only knows that he can do this, it sounds like you've done it already.
I haven't done it with the Junior Chicken. I've done it with the McDouble, which is roughly the same size buns. So therefore, I would think I could...
If we take off the Junior Chicken and we can make it a nugget. It's just quantity.
I was watching Hot Ones with Shaq, and I was losing my mind with how small those little drums look in his hand. So does it mean that, like, for the individual, like, does it matter, like, when it becomes a nugget for each person?
Is everyone's nugget different?
It's like equity, right? Like, you know, it's not It's not what, not equity. What's that word?
There's a negative
word. Subjectivity?
Like, yeah. So like,
yeah, equity is a very different word.
We have equality where it's like everyone gets the same size chicken nugget.
Or equity where it's scaled.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay. I see what you're saying. I see where you're coming from.
Shaq.
Equity. Okay.
Yeah, because if Shaq was to try and eat a nugget that was like suitable for me.
Like a McChicken patty.
To him, it wouldn't be a nugget. It would just be like a crumb.
He just opens like an 8-piece and is like, crumbs again.
Okay, okay, okay. When does a nugget go down to popcorn chicken?
Oh, popcorn chicken is brown.
Is it its own thing?
Yeah, it's its own thing.
I always thought that's because it's spherical. And like, it's actually the same size as popcorn.
You could have a sphere nugget.
But I'm saying it's also the same size as popcorn. Popcorn does not come in different sizes. Popcorn is popcorn.
I've seen some pretty large popcorn.
Yeah, there's some.
Are you just talking about like a one-off weird large kernel, or like a bag of big kernels? Because I've never seen a bag of big kernels. I've had the one-off here and there, but that's a mutant. I'm talking about generic popcorn size.
I'm talking about Monsanto created giant popcorns the size of your head.
So when does popcorn chicken become boneless wings?
What?
Ooh, actually, I've had this discussion with coworkers that
wings don't exist. Boneless wings are chicken nuggets.
Chicken nuggets. It's just branding.
It's just to make the wusses feel better. You are eating chicken nuggies, it was tossed in sauce. It's chicken nuggies with less steps, actually.
Yeah. Well, you gotta like debone.
No, you're just processing and you're just reshaping it into a, like...
A boot?
It's a nugget formation. It's still a nugget. It's not a wing. It's a nugget.
True.
It's by tossing it in the sauce that you make it a boneless wing.
But you can still do...
So it's not the size, it's not the chicken, it is the sauce application.
So I could take some McDonald's chicken nuggets, take the sauce and just smother them with it instead of dipping it, and boom.
Boneless wings.
Boneless. Wingy.
Oh, it's too small to be a bonus.
McDonald's, call us. We cracked the code. We're going to add a menu item for you with no extra cost.
This has been a weird turn of events.
I mean, I think chicken science is very, very important.
It is important.
Yeah, we were investigating chicken science earlier.
Poultry science.
Oh, about the cuckoos. The cuckoos.
Kyle and I watched Death Battle, and one of the guys is a registered poultry scientist.
Hold up.
No, cuckoos.
We're not having this conversation.
Poultry scientist.
Yes.
Oh, it's poultry science,
No,
Kyle.
We're not having this conversation.
The theme of today is poultry science.
We're not having this conversation.
Okay, but I want to throw it out to the viewers.
No!
We can't, why don't you want to ask the viewers, Kyle?
Hey, does Twitter have a poll button?
Everything has a
poll button.
Well, put it on Twitter!
Why?
Because I like Twitter.
Why? Twitter?
This is facts. Rob is addicted to Twitter. We need to help him.
I don't think I'm addicted. I post maybe once or twice a week.
So the general disagreement here for our listeners is the cuckoos from Legend of Zelda, can they fly?
No.
I say they can. I say cuckoos fly.
I think that there are cuckoos.
The evolved... Okay, hold on.
Chickens.
The evolved ones from whatever that...
Breath of the Wild?
That's it. From
the
Breath of the
Wild.
The
ones that are all, like, colorful and stuff. They're roosters.
Those ones, yes. They can fly. They're evolved.
I think that the ones from, like, the Game Boy, they can fly. I saw the ones from Link to the Past. They can fly because the animation, blah, 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 blah. I get it. The ones from Ocarina of Time can't fly...
No. We just see them come in.
They just like swoop
Kyle,
down.
Kyle argues they jump.
Okay, here's my theory.
They don't fly.
Nope, they do not fly. But they're expert jumpers like fleas and can jump like 40 yards and glide down from a very high distance.
So
imagine like one in a hallway and it jumps up like 40 feet and like glides down at an angle.
Yeah, like, you can throw a chicken off a roof, it'll glide down.
Yes.
I mean, I've never thrown one of my parents' chickens off a roof to see if they glide.
Why would you yeet the chicken? Poor
chickens.
I never yeeted a chicken. I only have two related chicken stories. One was when I decided to grab a chicken for Andrew to pet, and it bit him.
Ah, he got bit by a chicken! Yeah.
And the other is, I want to see how Kratos would react to chickens. So I opened the chicken coop for Kratos to see the chickens. And the chickens attacked him.
Good.
Viciously or anything, but I thought like the chickens would be chickens.
Well, I wanted the chickens to stand up for themselves in case there was ever a predator, and now I know that
they can. Oh, no. My parents have lost a couple chickens because of foxes.
Oh, cuckoos are not chickens, though. Or cuckoos. How do you pronounce... Okay, cuckoo. So question ones. How do you pronounce cuckoos?
I don't know.
Cuckoo? That makes me uncomfortable now with the internet.
Yes.
Cuckoo.
A cuckoo.
Okay,
so, and can they fly?
No, I believe that the ones in, like, the Ocarina of Time can't fly. I believe that the ones in Breath of the Wild can fly. And I believe the ones on the Game Boy can fly. But there is, like, other ones that can't. From the videos that I saw, some of them can.
So the examples where we distinctly saw them swoop in but not flying away.
The ones from Breath of the Wild swooped in and then flew away.
Yes.
Okay? The ones from Ocarina of Time swooped in, landed, and then walked around.
Yes.
Okay?
And Majora's Mask.
I guess that's just like, that Hyrule is that they can't fly there, I guess. Gravity and all that. Whatever.
So, cuckoos can fly most of the time.
Most of the time, I think that they can fly.
No, they can't.
In one case, they can fly.
No!
Yes. See, they fly! Kyle argues the game they were introduced doesn't count.
Because, the lack of animation does not mean they are flying. I guess it could be left up to interpretation of a 5-year-old. But... 5-year-olds are dumb.
Hot takes.
Wow,
on behalf of all 5-year-olds, I take personal offense to that, Kyle.
Good. Welcome to the world.
I think that you have to take into account, of course, limited ROM space of older cartridges,
yes.
And that the intent is to depict them flying as they are shown at a different plane than both our player and other cuckoos on the screen.
Do you know why?
Limited capacity.
Yeah, because the second you put them on the same plane, there goes all your art direction. They're in the building, they're crashing the building, then immediately your game's gone.
So, from means of limitation, cuckoos fly.
Nope.
This is something that we have to like get in contact with the person that created The Legend of Zelda.
It'd be Eiji Onuma would be the most foremost expert still working within it right now, because he took over the series after Majora's Mask.
Make a good game series.
Well, Kyle doesn't like Zelda, but he still has passionate opinions upon it.
Yeah,
okay, actually, hold on. I like a couple of them. Breath of the Wild was kind of fun for what I played.
Okay.
That's it.
No, A Link to the Past is a good one.
Yes, thank you.
A Link to the Past is a good one.
It's the best one.
And then...
Arguably.
Can't give you another one.
Well...
that's good.
Go to our Twitter, twitter.com/ThunderGeeks, and you guys can vote. And
we'll find out, do cuckoos fly?
And next... So I left the poll open for 1 week, so next week, we'll see what the people say. I'm kind of curious because I have no stake in this one at all.
So dumb.
Hey, maybe you guys should make it a bet.
A bet.
No.
I don't know. I'm cool leaving this up to the people. I believe in the people.
The only thing that Andrew and Kyle care about is bragging rights and being right. That's literally the only thing that these two care about.
But here's
the only thing that these two care about is being right.
Yep.
And that's winning this bet, like that's all they care, that's all they want.
Yeah, but
they just want to be right.
And the thing is, I know that even if like one side gets like 100% of the votes and like 100 people vote, the other side will be like, "No, I'm still right."
Still right.
That's these people.
I'm right.
Yeah, they like bragging rights, but they're also stubborn.
So stubborn.
Because my way is right.
You guys say I'm the stubborn one.
Speaking of stubborn things that won't leave, hey Kyle, what about the video game awards?
All right.
Oh, you know what?
How much money
beautiful segue.
Did Hideo Kojima...
Hideo Kojima.
Yeah, Hideo Kojima and Norman Reedus's bank account. Oh, did they shovel to be in, like, every category?
This is what...
And then they won, like, three
Jeff
or four of
Keighley
them.
Jeff Keighley has been wanting for his whole life. Literally, the Game Awards were made so he could have Hideo Kojima sitting front row and center. This is what he's wanted for 1 million years. This is why the Game Awards exist.
He paid for it. It's fine. And then, at least...
The thing is, that's...
Okay.
We recognize it more in gaming, but that's kind of how most award shows go. That
facts.
The more promotion you put out to the selection committee, the more likely you are to be nominated.
I'm kind of thankful it didn't win Game of the Year. Very thankful it didn't. Sekiro did.
What was that?
Sekiro.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. I loved how Vin Diesel pronounced it.
Sekiro!
No, he's like, I'm the winner.
Sekiro.
Sekiro.
Sekiro. Vin Diesel, for some reason. And Letty. Remember, don't forget Letty.
I can understand at least Vin Diesel because he is an open geek. He's like, I've played D&D in high school a lot.
They have a game coming out.
Like
it
I said.
It looks so bad.
Hold on. Oh. Okay, so Michelle Rodriguez was actually a voice. Yes, Michelle Rodriguez is Letty's name. She's actually been involved in a lot of video games doing voices. And she was in a couple of live action trailers and stuff too.
See, here's the thing though, and I hate to sound condescending with this, but if you're voice acting in a
video
game,
you never hate to sound condescending. That's a dirty lie.
I don't like to sound condescending to
you. Don't
the
like
public,
getting
to you.
Okay.
I love condescending you. But no, what I'm saying is just because you're a voice actor in a video game doesn't necessarily mean you like or appreciate video games. It's a job. If someone says, "Here's a few hundred thousand dollars, say these lines." Okay. Like, there has been other voice actors who have said they don't like the medium they do, but it's a job.
So what do you want? You want, like, proof? You, like, want to go to her house and, like, play, like, some Street Fighter against her or something?
I mean, yeah, sure. Let's do this.
I mean, same, but whatever. I just want to hang out with Michelle Rodriguez.
I'm not saying she is or she isn't. I'm just saying the fact that she works in the industry is not proof one way or the other.
So you want to go over to Vin Diesel's house and, like, play some games with him then?
Yeah. See, Vin Diesel, I know if I... Like, I don't know, but it'd be cool if I went to Vin Diesel's and it's like, hey, want to do a D&D campaign?
Who are you? Security?
I mean,
Does Vin Diesel need security? He's kind of his own security.
He doesn't want to... I mean, you don't want to hurt the glamour muscles, you know? Like, you need those.
Yeah, there's no doubt in my mind, though. He wouldn't even need them, but... Like, Vin Diesel's, there's a few, I can't remember what it was called, but there was a short-lived YouTube series that was a D&D campaign starring Vin Diesel.
Nice.
I'm just, like, The Last Witch Hunter, bad movie, but it's totally based on one of his campaigns.
Nice. I want to play that now. I want to watch
Halo
it.
Too.
There you go.
As Marine.
There was another one. I can't remember the name of it right now, but it was, Chinese Mafia. Why am I forgetting the name of it? It was
Yakuza?
Really, no, the Chinese Mafia!
Triad?
No, yeah.
Shenmue?
Nope, not that one. It was, super over the top. You could, like, bam, bam, you could, like, jump and, like, kick stuff.
Are you talking about True Crime Streets of LA?
Yes! True Crime Streets of LA! She was in that game.
Totally. Where did you get a Chinese?
Yeah, no, she's right.
I know, but
she's right. That was that was the game.
This is how I see. That's the game.
She's not wrong.
Thank you.
There's like 8 game series that are literally based around you being in the Chinese mafia.
Uh huh.
And so you pick True Crime Streets of LA.
Uh huh.
Which kind of has the Chinese mafia in it.
I know, that's like the end boss.
Yeah,
you fight a dragon.
The end boss.
You go from GTA and then you fight a dragon, Kyle. And
so like GTA.
The point is I'm right. So, you know, that's all that matters.
I'm right.
Thank you. Yes, you're
right. I'm right.
You're right.
Don't take this
right.
from me.
Oh my God, what?
I don't want to share.
Oh, fine.
Andrew.
Yeah?
Good job on being right. Anyways, so other Game Award things. CTR, Crash Team Racing, won an award for best sports racing game.
It did.
What else was up?
I guess there was other sports and racing games.
I guess, it was the only kart racer this year.
It was the only one that mattered.
What was it any? I used to love the original CTR, but I haven't looked at the series in a long time. Was this one actually good?
I don't know. Never played it. It's not Mario Kart, but...
It's never been Mario Kart.
I thought Mario Kart was going to win Mobile Game of the Year.
What won Mobile Game of the Year?
Yeah. Call of Duty.
Call of Duty Mobile won Game of the Year.
Okay,
for
hold on. So you turn your face down. Now, I've been a frequent player recently of a mobile app.
Playing
Call
is,
of Duty.
Player is usually a strong term when you talk about mobile games, Kyle.
No, there's no auto...
There's no auto battle.
Hold on. Let me reiterate that sentence. There's no auto battle. However, when you kind of bring your gun up to aim, it just auto fires. So all you got to kind of do is be able to aim at people with a phone.
Okay, no, it's not bad.
It's also got zombies.
Zombies.
I mean, did it actually translate well? Because that was the thing that baffled me about Mario Kart. I did not expect it to work. And when I heard what they were doing, I'm like, that sounds stupid.
It works so well. Yeah. No, like, there was at one point I went 31-0.
I'm kind of impressed if you can put a first-person shooter into...
I'm impressed.
Because I'm playing a sniper.
Of course.
So I'm sitting in the back. Because they handed...
Camper.
They handed us all a free
weapon. It's a legitimate strategy.
No, it's not. But they handed us all, like, a free sniper rifle over Christmas. And they were like, here you go. And I'm like, okay. I just started, so I had a pea shooter.
Pew, pew.
Oh, it's 100% pay to win.
Oh.
Honey pea. Honeybee, there's a gun, there's a selection of guns, there's the loot crate boxes you can get that give you better guns.
Gambling
for 13-year-olds.
Gambling for 13-year-olds.
Kyle's a 13-year-old!
In my day, they called that Chuck E. Cheese.
Oh my god, you would too, you edgelord.
I almost matched my, like, sniper rifle to my outfit there.
Oh,
I'm trying.
Oh my gosh. Okay, so Kyle's cod sona here.
Cod sona? He's a fish.
My weapon's called Big Shark.
It's literally...
You're proving me right.
It's like, okay, so his sniper rifle has, like, a picture of a shark on it. And
it's a big shark.
And it's got, like, blue... So it looks like it's underwater, but some of the pieces are, like, red gradient. Ooh, look like blood in the water. And then his entire, like, all of his gear is, like, a whitish, kind of black scheme. And then his sunglasses are, like, PC Principal's sunglasses.
Oh!
And they're red, and they're, like, shiny. Oh, my gosh.
Well... Just like a shark, I hope you guys take a bite out of these commercials. We're going to head to our next break here. Guys, thank you so much for tuning in. Of course, we're your Thunder Geeks, brought to you by 102.7 FM CILU. Around the world at luradio.ca or streaming video live at facebook.com/ThunderGeekSpeak. We'll be right back. And we're back. You're listening to Thunder Geeks, brought to you by 102.7 FM CILU. Around the world at luradio.ca or streaming video live at facebook.com/ThunderGeekSpeak. That was 90s Kid and with by Jordan Rabor. No.
Sure.
Jordan Rabjohn.
Sure.
A dude sang a song for us.
Show us up on Spotify.
Welcome back. So.
So Chicky Nuggies, video games, what else we got?
Let's talk about true love.
True love.
Since you're looking at me like that, that could either mean food or comic books.
Option B.
Okay, so we're talking Harley.
So good.
Yeah, and trust me, as a fanboy of the show, of the comics and character in general, whenever a show is trying to do something different or new, that's when I go, because, well... DC doing hard R shows. I Titans has been okay, but I feel like they're unnecessarily making it a hard R. Whereas with Harley, it fits with her character and her character dynamics.
I'd agree with that comparing. Like, there's nothing in Titans that requires it to be a hard R series because it's usually just superfluous language that doesn't add anything to the scene.
Yeah.
There's a couple brutal things, but I think those would still get a PG-13.
Yeah. Like, I've always had the belief that if you're a good enough writer, you don't need to depend on swears.
And there's not that much sex in Titans.
No. So with Harley Quinn, when they announced the series that it'd be an R-rated one, I'm like, you don't need to make everyone swear. It's cool.
R-rated animated, too.
Yeah. So the animated I was game for. Because with animation, you can always go that extra mile of silly, crazy, and
DC comic book. Better.
Yeah. So only 3 episodes are out right now. But like from the first few moments of the Harley Quinn anime series, I'm like, I am so in.
That was pretty good.
The series starts with a bunch of guys on a yacht bragging about how they're rich and white and they like stomping on the poor. I'm like, all right, I love that humor. And then Harley Quinn bursts in. They're like, oh, Joker's girlfriend. She's like, I'm not just that. And then Joker bursts in too and kind of steals the limelight from her.
Yep.
She then spends a year in Arkham. Waiting for the Joker to break her out. And we get to meet some of the other villains. This is like a villain-heavy show. Like, Batman's in it for like 5 seconds.
I do appreciate who they brought back to play Batman.
Yes, they get Diedrich Baker, the voice from Brave and the Bold, to play Batman. And this show also has the best Commissioner Gordon.
I love him. He's so just done. Tweaked.
Done.
He's had like far too many coffees and he's so angry. Like,
yeah, he is. He is beaten down.
I love it.
But the relationship between Harley and Ivy is adorable. They are like the bestest of friends.
It's so genuine too.
Like, yeah.
It's not played up to be something that it's not. And it's like, oh, finally. Realism.
Yeah, it's so as much as I do like Harley, I do feel like whenever she's written in the comics with Ivy, they kind of go the very sexual route. They don't explicitly say it, but they're like, hey, they're wink, wink, nudge, nudge, you know.
They just like fool around in their lingerie. Ha ha, kiss, kiss. Oh my god.
It's gratuitous.
Yeah. With this, it genuinely feels like just two friends hanging out and like, a good chunk of the first episode is Ivy just going, it's like, you know the Joker is garbage and treats you like trash. And she's like, oh, that's just your opinion. And all of Arkham's like, he's garbage.
Yeah, they're just like, no, he really treats you awfully.
I love it. I love Ivy. There's so much about her that's great.
Ivy's probably my favorite.
Yeah.
This show is also giving me my favorite out of context quote. I will have to paraphrase for the radio, but it's the Riddler running by saying, I ain't an orange, I pooped out a seed. just that scene.
How
I love
is this happening? He just runs by.
I love the Riddler in this.
Bane is one of my other favorites.
Oh my god,
Bane! With his just awkward comments in the back, he's just like, I'm gonna go blow up the stadium.
He's just gets so hurt.
I like how they'll make fun of the entire like DC, like, I don't want to say mythos. Yeah, that's anything that's been released by DC, they'll crack jokes about and stuff. But for this one, they give him his like more classical Bane look, but they give him Tom Hardy's voice.
Yep.
So we get the best brain again. And it was at a trivia night and they had slighted me, so I blew up Gotham Stadium.
I also love the fact that like a good chunk of the humor doesn't come from like supervillains doing supervillain stuff. It's just hanging out.
It's the mundane stuff in between of how do these huge egomaniacs actually interact with each other?
You still see them on like TV destroying buildings.
Yeah.
Like doing their heists and stuff.
Yeah.
Like when Harley gets dropped into acid because of the Riddler and it turns out it's margarita mix, there's this hilarious conversation between Riddler and Poison Ivy about Costco memberships.
Yeah.
And I love that. Or the joke Harley does where she finds Riddler's hideout and it's just this giant sphinx with Riddler's face and she just goes, how do the heroes not find this?
And like Ivy's hideout is literally just a giant area covered in plants. Everybody's like, where's that hideout?
But episode 2 gives me my favorite, now thankfully running, joke of Kite Man.
You're okay. I hate Kite Man.
You're supposed to, Megan, but you hate him for the right reasons, right? He's hilarious. You laughed.
When he comes in.
Why do you hate Kite Man, Megan?
Oh, do I really have to tell you why
yes.
I hate Kite Man?
Well, our listeners may not know.
Why do you hate Kite Man, Megan?
Because every person has met a kite man.
Yes.
A person we've met many kite men in our lives. These kite men.
You mean guys that try to swoop in for one night and just drift away?
No, not even that. It's like just a kite. The way that they act. Weather. They just don't take the hint, you know? And then there's one moment in episode 3 where Kite Man shows up again and Harley mentions it to Ivy, and Ivy's like, oh yeah, that guy's a jerk. He didn't mention my name, did he?
Did he mention my name?
And I swear to God, if they make Ivy have a crush on Kite Man, I will riot.
Kite Man! No, it's not about that. It's not about Ivy having a crush on Kite Man. It's that they shared a moment and now it's that inherent suspicion awkwardness. And awkward and jealousy.
Yep.
But I don't take it as the kindling of a relationship.
No.
More as
you
had it.
Because there are sometimes where you mistake a moment for more than just a moment.
That's Kite Man's existence.
But yeah, I do love the whole Kite Man. In episode 2, Harley decides to bust in on a Legion of Doom event because
she's going to go crash the party.
And she thinks it's a party, and it turns out it's the Penguin's nephew's bar mitzvah, featuring Two-Face, Bane, and Scarecrow just hanging out there eating food. Like,
Bane didn't get to eat.
Yeah.
Yeah, Bane didn't get to eat.
Bane! Joker took his food and was like, oh, I'm going to try yours, too.
I ordered the beef ahead of time. You didn't even want to come to this stupid thing.
And like I said, it's the mundane. It's not the supervillain stuff. It's a bar mitzvah, and Harley mistakes it as a party. But even after she realizes what it is, she's just like, "No, I'm staying."
In for a penny, in for a pound.
Yep.
And I gotta say, there.
Or Ivy's roommate.
Yeah, Ivy's roommate. Frank is a plant, sentient plant.
He's a man.
But yeah, so Kite Man steals Poison Ivy's poison and drugs the kids.
So they start turning into plants?
Who are deeply in love with Poison Ivy.
The brazen on that kid that comes back with like a little stick in his hand. He's like, round 2. Got a little bit left in me.
So the only cure is at Ivy's apartment, and it can only be administered one way. And these kids are like, so the kids.
Well, they're 13. They're 13-year-old boys.
With Poison Ivy.
And the most powerful female supervillain has to kiss them to save their lives. Ivy's reaction is just, this is just procedural. Don't make a thing about this. This is the way this thing works.
But I do got to give credit to that last kid who had the chutzpah to come back around you, holding a tree that's like, yeah, I'm still part tree.
I'm hook, line, and sinker on this one.
Oh, we forgot to mention who even voices Harley. It's Penny from The Big Bang Theory. And she is, like, spot on for the role.
I did not know. Wow. Can't remember. She's fantastic. Yeah, I can't remember her name either.
Kaylee Cuckoo?
Cuckoo? Yeah.
Cuckoo.
We're just coming back to those.
Can she fly?
Probably
no
first
powers.
Class.
Yeah, so she is like nailing the voice acting because I love Tara Strong as Harley.
Tara did a great job, but the new voice actor, she's bringing a great energy to the role, and
it's a different Harley. Like, in the first episode, she dumps Joker. She realizes, oh, this is toxic.
Not so much. So that's something that I appreciate they showed as well, is how the Joker ropes her back in each time.
Yeah.
Where, you know, after of being a year in Arkham, she, you know, goes to the Joker, you know, like, I'm going to break up this time. And the Joker goes, like, no, I care about you so much that I had to keep you away from me to protect you.
Because they were gonna get to you,
so I have to break up with you. Unless.
Unless.
And it's this perpetual cycle. But the way that she breaks through it all.
I love this part.
This part's fantastic. So, Ivy shows, you know, well, compliments Harley as Dr. Quinzel, saying, you know, the only reason I was able to ever get my handle on myself was because of you, and that establishes why they're friends. So she shows Harley a picture of herself before she became Harley Quinn. And then, of course, Harley Quinn proceeds to have a conversation with herself in the picture.
And it's like looking into a little box, almost. Like, yes. It's so cool how they animated this. And it just shows that, like, Harley is crazy. Like, don't forget, Harley's crazy.
Absolutely nuts, but wicked intelligent. She still remembers everything from when she was still, like, a psychiatrist.
Yes.
Isn't that, like, a 7-year course?
Yeah, it's very long.
Yes.
It's very
long. Let alone getting access to the world's most infamous crazy person, it takes quite a bit to get there. Episode 3, like, they tackle the inequality between, like, male and female supervillains. The glass ceiling, but they not only tackle it from, like, the perspective of it's just no male supervillain takes you seriously, they're all chauvinist pigs, and you can't even get a crew to be hired. Where they flip it around as well that they... I love this voice cameo. They bring in Wanda Sykes to play a character called the Queen of Fables, who brings storybook characters to life to be her crew. But instead of getting sent to Arkham like every other supervillain does, they imprison her in a book for the U.S. tax code for the rest of her life. And she's like, if I was a man, I would just be in prison instead of being a book.
A chain-smoking book.
I do like how Megan actually pointed this out, that her pages are yellow.
Yeah, she smokes.
I didn't notice that the first time. I'm like, oh, yeah, that's actually really...
Small details. Small comedic details.
Like, there's a lot of small details. Like, Andrew, you didn't notice this until the second time of all of the blur.
Okay.
On Maxim Zeus.
I love that they're also giving obscure characters some time to shine, because that's something that Brave and the Bold got to do as well, where it showed some of the Batman supervillain rogue that they've been around, but they're rather outdated, stupid, or they're never going to get adapted for live action. They are never going to do Maxi Zeus. Ever. Maxi Zeus's whole thing is that he's just a crazy guy that thinks he's Zeus, and is super strong, and occasionally gets, you know, lightning bolts, but I don't believe usually. I think he's had to attack once. He's just a dude.
With a weird wiener. What is he in this? He's a motivational speaker?
For supervillains.
What I didn't notice is that I'm trying to remember the movie where she's sitting on a chair and crosses her legs.
I know exactly.
Instinct?
Basic instinct.
Maxi Zeus has a basic instinct moment in this, and they blur it out. But then what I didn't realize for the rest of the entire episode...
His junk's blurred.
If you look at the statues, each one of them have a blur on the junk.
Oh, not just that. Like, there's scenes where it's like when he's being up Clayface and jumping, they blur. He doesn't wear underwear.
He's a Greek god. He doesn't have to.
Toga, toga, toga.
Please don't let Rob ever wear a toga for this reason.
Never.
I only wore one once.
Oh, gosh. Did you wear underwear?
No, it was college.
Oh, exactly. This is... Okay,
I mean, when you go to a toga party, that's...
Rob never wears underwear. Can't trust him with a toga. Neither can we trust you.
You never wear underwear, period, so yeah. I think Kyle's the most trustworthy in a toga.
I still wouldn't trust it.
I mean, I've seen him in a hospital gown, which is pretty similar.
I don't like doing naked, so...
Togas.
But yeah, so a lot of blurred genitalia in this one.
The whole thing's about getting a crew.
Yes.
So she has to go and get...
A crew. The worst of the worst.
The worst.
The crew that no one wants to hire. And we start off with...
let's talk about her first attempt. Because before she goes to Maxi Zeus, you know, she tries to go to a temp agency. And they're like, oh, you're not with the Joker anymore? Okay, you gotta leave. And then she goes to a seedy bar. And everyone's like, oh, no, I got a thing.
And then the guy even commits suicide to get out of it.
And then Kite Man shows up. He's like, hey, you guys feel about a heist? Like, I don't know what we're going to do yet. Like, depends on the weather, but let's go. And everyone's like, oh, yeah, heist! Everyone leaves.
Poor Harley.
I guess the reason why Dr. Psycho can't get a job is because he called Wonder Woman the C word.
Yep.
And I just love how everything, including the Earth, just freeze.
Just the Earth stops.
Like, I can actually imagine IRL Wonder Woman, if someone called her that, it's like, he dead. He is dead.
Then, like, the rest of the Justice League is like, oh.
Uh-oh. Like, this reminds me of a hilarious, like, fan comic done of when Wonder Woman gets serious, she ties up her hair, and Batman's scared, and it's like, just a comic of Batman going, oh, she got the scrunchie, you done for!
I think I remember scrunchie that one.
The standout for me this episode, hands down, is Clayface. I've never seen Clayface portrayed like this, but it makes sense because an integral part of Clayface's backstory is that he's an actor.
Yes.
That over-exaggerated thespian actor.
And this one, he's now a grandiose actor. And not just that, he's the actor that will overthink their role. I think, like, if Clayface wasn't, like, a supervillain, he'd probably be working community theater right now. He would have his one-man show that plays on Tuesdays.
Or he'd be the real-life Shia LaBeouf.
Shia LaBeouf can also transform into any role.
I mean, didn't he, like, break his jaw for a role?
Do you know he's actually been Scarlett Johansson this entire time?
What?
Well, now I'm confused in more ways than one.
Do you know she was a broom this whole time?
Just tips over, clatters.
It's a bag of oranges.
Yikes. Isn't he like a method actor? Like, he has to like get way into character.
Well, like, usually in the comics, like, they don't lean on this part of his story that much. Like, after he becomes the monster, it's just the excuse of why he's able to transform so well. But they never explain that. It's like, no, he actually really loved acting.
So now he gets to play every character.
And he does that, you know, and whether he's playing the country home farm boy who's moved to the big city to bartend.
Or the best mailman ever.
Or Maxie Seuss' long-lost son who's also a mailman. And it was bar singer Julie, I believe.
No, piano bar.
Yeah, piano bar Julie.
Janet.
There was the J in there. Yeah. So, Harley goes and recruits, what's his name?
Dr. Psycho
and Clayface to pull a petty heist on Maxie Seuss and go steal the 1996 Olympic gold medals from him.
Yep. Because he literally sleeps on them.
And I gotta say, I kind of loved it. But there was one part that kind of confused me where Maxie's about to, like, what's it called? Like a pile driver on Clayface?
Yep.
And he's like, this is gonna be the last hit. I'm like, isn't Clayface an amorphous blob? You can't actually kill him via blunt force.
He's also a god that's gonna think that everything he does is.
I do gotta admit, it is kind of funny seeing Clayface has bitten his tongue.
Yeah. Just drop the lisp. I just can't bit my tongue.
My only hesitation now is this is they often with Harley when she's put into media, you don't get to see Harley emancipated. Like most times with adaptation so far, it's you can't really tell Harley Quinn's story without starting out with a Joker, and then they often don't get beyond that. With the new Suicide Squad movie, it's the emancipation of Harley Quinn. I'm worried now that I'm enjoying this so much. It might bring the movie down if it gets over-cluttered. I'm going to trust James Gunn that it's going to work.
It's James Gunn.
But I'm hoping that, because that's happened to me before where I've seen them adapt something fantastically in animated form. And then when they tried it in live action, it's like, oh, well, that sucked.
Yeah.
Well, at least we finally have a good standalone Harley Quinn thing.
Yeah, no, the animated series is fantastic. I'm glad DC All Access has been putting out pretty decent content. Like, Titans is really the big misstep.
Yeah.
But elsewise, Doom Patrol and this is... And the new season of Young Justice.
Oh, I need to catch up. Oh, please, no, don't say nothing. I hide now because I haven't gotten to finish Young Justice, and I want it so bad.
Okay, I won't spoil it for you, but any complaint that I had about it fixed itself by the end of the season.
Because I remember the last thing I remember was Molten Lava Boy trying to learn how to control his molten lava powers.
Yes.
Geo Force, yes.
Was there a shark girl?
No.
No. Oh.
I see where you're going, though. I appreciate it.
Oh.
Yikes.
I mean, there was a shark boy, so it could be shark boy and lava boy.
Ah, it's King Shark.
Not the same.
I want King Shark and Geoforce.
His name is Geoforce?
His name is Geoforce.
Oh. Shrugs.
Well, on that note, folks, we'll head to our next break here. Guys, thank you so much for tuning into Thunder Geeks, brought to you by 102.7 FM CILU, around the world at luradio.ca, or streaming video live at facebook.com/ThunderGeeksSpeak. We'll be right back.
CILU is sponsored in part by the students of Lakehead University, our listeners, and our sponsors. At this time, we would like to thank the following sponsors for their continuous support.
The Thunder Bay Country Market, keeping it local every Saturday from 8 a.m. to 1 p.m. and every Wednesday from 3:30 to 6:30 p.m. year-round. Stop by and say hi to over 80 vendors who make it, bake it, and grow it in the Dove Building located on the CLE grounds. Sensia Corporate Web Solutions. Log on to sensia.ca for information about locally owned and operated hosting, site creation, and more. The Study Coffee House. The Study is a fully licensed, intimate live venue and the place to get your caffeine fix while on the Lakehead University campus.
This is Vegeta, and you're listening to Thunder Geeks on 102.7 FM CILU.
And we're back. You're listening to Thunder Geeks, brought to you by 102.7 FM CILU, around the world at luradio.ca, or streaming live at facebook.com/ThunderGeeksSpeak. That, of course, was Kari Marin with Follow My Brain.
Follow my brain.
I mean, does anyone here have a brain to follow?
I do.
Megan does.
Yeah.
So, Megan, what have you been up to this week?
Been doing big brain time. With Black Sad, Under the Skin. Under the skin. Under the fur. Okay, so just to get things right on the table right now.
Furries!
They're furries, okay? No tails, though.
What?
And
I'm out.
None of the legs that have, like, the backwards
knees?
Knees.
They're all just humans.
They're just anthropomorphic, I guess. You could use that word.
Scary.
Yeah, it was based off of a Black Horse comic.
You mean Dark Horse?
Yeah, Dark Horse. Dark Horse comic.
Black Sad,
Black
Dark
Sad,
Horse.
Black Sad, Dark Horse.
Green Grass, High Tides.
Great song.
So, yeah, so this game, I was pretty hyped for this game for a while. Because it's just different. It's like, it's totally new. Because, you know, you don't really see a whole lot of anthropomorphic characters anymore. I mean, you do, but you don't. Essentially...
There's kind of... I mean... the last I think we saw was Zootopia, but they're...
Yeah.
I think previously, part of the reason they were... You would see more anthropomorphic animated characters was because those were easier to draw exaggerated, where humans would often just look weird and wrong.
Yes.
Now they don't want to use them because all those ones that they drew before have too much Rule 34 on the internet. So
yikes.
Unless it's part of the marketing, they're like, you know what I don't want to do?
This game makes me happy that I'm no longer in certain forums anymore.
Oh.
Because, again, they're furries, right? So there's going to be a lot of it going around. I can just see the internet just taking it and running.
If it exists, there
is stuff of it, so I'm gonna assume that there is. So Black Sad is our main protagonist, John Black Sad. He is
uncomfortably buff cat.
A tuxedo cat. He was in the military, come on.
Oh, that's why he's a jarhead?
That's why he's a jarhead.
His head literally looks like a jar.
Literally looks like a jar. Honestly, the comic does look a little bit better.
The comic looks 100% better.
I looked up the studio that did this, and they haven't done, like, a whole lot before this. So this is, like, their big title, right? So this is probably, like, the first one that's going to hopefully get, like, some traction.
Bigger license.
Yeah, yeah. It's a detective game, whodunit, 1920s style.
Mm.
It's a slow burn sort of...
like choose your own adventure?
Yeah, essentially. Like a Telltale game. You play as a detective, and...
The butler did it.
The butler did it. They actually talk about the difference between an American whodunit and, like, a British style of like when you meet
like murder mystery.
Like yeah, when you meet someone at the beginning, as you're conversing with.
Yeah, no, I didn't know there was a difference in like the style they presented.
Yeah. So in the British in British literature, usually like murder mystery stuff, you always meet the murderer right at the beginning. You've known them from the start.
Okay. Like Scooby-Doo.
Yeah. And then in America, it's a lot of the time you don't meet them until like the last chapter, the whodunit. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So they actually brought that up.
That's something I'd never thought about.
Yeah. So essentially, Black Sad is you start off by facing this rhino who is really, really mad at you because you took pictures of him having an affair.
Oh, because a cat could definitely take down a rhino.
So you get the choice to either punch him or headbutt him, and it doesn't matter which you choose because a rhino has a giant horn in the front of its face.
Yeah, don't fight rhinos.
That should be a song. So don't fight rhinos.
Yeah. Rob, a pretty good detective, I see.
So then you can just like you just smash him across the head with a typewriter. So whatever. Everything is time based as well, and you can choose which way you want to go.
Is this one of those games where not choosing is still a choice?
Not choosing is still a choice. So you can just choose to get totally beaten to pieces by this rhino. I will say, I've had it out for this rhino since the beginning. He's not alive anymore.
Yeah. Megan, they endangered, yo!
Well, I mean...
What'd you do with the horn, Megan?
Well, oh no. Oh no, that's dark. So basically his wife hired you to investigate whether or not he was having an affair. Turns out that he was. And then...
Now you're the poor schlub caught in the middle.
And you're...
I was working.
I was, you know...
in a dock.
He smokes so much!
Well, he's all do.
He smokes of so course. Much!
I'm surprised the game's not in black and white.
True.
It's so good, and then...
maybe they would have got the mouth to match if it was.
When he leaves, when Colbert leaves, you get approached by this other kitty cat. She is more of a mancoon. She approaches you, and she says...
Meow, 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 meow.
I need you to find my father's protege.
Oh, she's the one that looks like she's from Planet of the Apes.
Yeah. No. What? No, yeah. She's a cat. She's...
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the what? Cat thing that
the
looks
cat,
like
the cat, Planet of the female Apes. Cat, but it looked like it's from Planet of the Apes.
Oh, okay. Anyways, I forget her name. Sonia. Sonia Dunn.
She's Sonia Dunn.
She's like, my father he's committed suicide, and I need you to find his protege, this Rottweiler, who needs to fight... this bull in like 2 weeks, otherwise I lose my gym, like my father's gym. It's gonna be gone, and I own this now, but if he doesn't fight, we're not gonna have enough money.
It's the
to
Rottweiler.
Keep the gym. You can figure out, you can either accuse the Rottweiler or you can choose to try and find other deductions. The more clues you gather, Blue's Clues. The more clues you gather, you get a little notification that you have a deduction.
Okay.
And then you go into Black Sad's like mind space, where he has like all of his little clues, and then
so
you have to.
So it's like the Lovecraft game you made
it's,
me play.
It's kind of like the Lovecraft game that I made you play, where you go into like his
detective mode,
mind palace, detective mode, where he like and haws. So you'll get like two or three clues, and you have to combine them in a specific way to come to a conclusion. And then the more that you do, the more you can kind of figure out what is even going on. Because there's more than just he committed suicide.
Yeah.
Again, this game is a hard R. It's an M-rated game. There's a lot of times where if you make the wrong decision as Black Sad, you'll get your throat slit.
Ooh.
Actually, like, it's dark. Ooh. It's real dark. So you have to investigate his death, and there's all of these characters involved. And what's interesting about Black Sad is when you're prompted for a character that you is introduced to you, you can hear, sight, and smell.
I guess, yeah, cats, they can smell, but...
So you'll get, like, a little icon that says, like, it's, like, his little thing, and then you can go in and you can hone in your hearing to, like, listen into a conversation. Or you can, like, smell, like, oh, wow, this merry girl smells like burgers and cinnamon.
I'm just imagining, like, because he's got the cat ears, cool. You use, like, the two Joy-Cons and just, like, you move his ears, like, pew, 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 pew.
That would be actually...
To, like, tune in.
That would actually be a perfect way to do it. There are a lot of parts in this game that the mechanics are a little frustrating. It really gets on my nerves.
I mean,
it's to be expected, yeah?
My curiosity, because, like... Does the story carry the game more than the gameplay itself?
The story is definitely what you're playing this for, as opposed to the gameplay.
So I mean, like, if you're going to choose one or the other, probably read the comic? Or is it...
I mean, I would say it's based on the comic, but I don't think it goes, like, to it, like, for, like, word for word and everything. I definitely think that it explores more than what the comic book would give you.
Yeah.
Because you do have, like, pretty lengthy conversations and gather a lot of information about each individual. Like, you even keep it in a little journal. You can go back to it and say, like, oh, wow, well, Mary, you know, was dating Dunn. Cool. So she's a suspect, maybe, possibly. I don't know. It just gives you a more hands-on feel of it. The comic book would be great. But the gameplay is enjoyable, don't get me wrong. But again, since this is one of their, like, first kind of shots at a game like this.
Yeah.
I mean, I wouldn't just cut them so short, right? Does that make sense?
I haven't played the game. However, I never choose to play the game.
You gotta work for it, that's all. If you just read a comic book, it's just gonna give you all the right choices. In this one, if you don't make right choices, those can affect how the game is played.
But my problem is part of the presentation as well, where if you're going for a specifically conversational and story-driven game,
yeah,
and your mouse look like a Japanese dub of an old Godzilla movie, like the only thing I could think of was, like, was this originally in English? And it seems to be. It wasn't a French story or anything, really bad at matching, and things they have control over both, so...
Yeah.
Going backwards in graphics.
Yeah.
Judging from the new, Fast and Furious racing game.
Oh, is it Fast and Furious or is it Need for Speed?
No, it's
same thing.
Fast and Furious one.
Oh, okay. Well,
it's the Fast and Furious Need for Speed.
I wouldn't play Fast and Furious game. I would just play Need for Speed. I'd play the game that ripped off the movie.
It looks so bad. He looks like Mr. Clean in it.
Just make all of his character clothes just pure white.
Yeah. I guess I've just been really super addicted to these kinds of games lately. I've been making a lot of wrong speech options. There's been points where, it's like a timed, and I don't have enough time to read them all. Because I'm unfortunately a slow reader. It's just how I be. Like, I have to read stuff out loud to myself or else I won't retain it. So I'm just in my apartment talking to myself a lot.
I mean, that's how I pretty much it's like living with Kyle, because I'll always just hear his end of the conversation.
That's fair.
Oh, yeah, Kyle just brought up a screenshot of Vin Diesel inside of this game, and yeah, no, he does actually look like a very, very, like a 90s attempt at doing a 3D Mr. Clean.
He looks like Mr. Clean had a bad day.
He looks like PS2 Fast graphics. And Furious Crossroads.
He looks like Mr. Clean from Food Fight.
Oh, gosh.
He does. And anyone who's seen that, I'm so sorry.
But yeah, I've been unfortunately making the wrong speech decisions. And sometimes it'll affect, like, the gameplay, Mary wasn't impressed that you accused her of this. And I was like, I didn't want to, I was just trying to be playful, but no, I was just being a huge jerk, apparently.
So now we know Megan's idea of playful is being a huge jerk.
I don't know.
Megan is just exerting her toxic masculinity on this poor, poor woman.
Yeah, Megan.
Every choice you make, too, can change, it'll change John's personality, like his black.
Yeah.
You can go into the settings and see, like, quote-unquote, your black sad. So I'm super talkative because I just talk all the time because that's just me. Whoops. So I'm 97% talkative, but I played the game... What?
Oh, my.
Yeah.
I don't talk to anybody.
If I played the game, you can play it where you don't say, like, anything at all, and you just play the game.
Strong silent type.
I'm surprised that wasn't you, because, you know...
I wanted to play it like that, but then I figured, you know what, I'm just going to play it through how I would play it, and I accidentally made the wrong speech decisions. There's a cop Turns out he's a German Shepherd. He's the head of police. Yeah.
Because of course.
Because of course. You guys were buddies in the war. He's like, you want to be good cop or bad cop? And I chose good cop. But apparently I'm really bad at being good cop.
Oh.
And then it's like, you chose not to stick to good cop. And I was like, oh, no.
Megan, I've got a note. Is anyone on the police force a pig?
I haven't seen any piggies yet.
Are they all dogs?
No, they're not all dogs. So there's been like a goat lady, a cow lady, another kitty cat lady, a kitty cat lady. So
a lot of kitty cat ladies.
Sorry. There's a coyote.
Are they Jellicle cats?
A bull, another bull that's like all shaggy, like an ox. The rhino. There's a gorilla. And then there's a bear. And
ooh, daddy.
He's a boxer. Yeah, he's training in the ring, and you don't get.
So he's shirtless a lot.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm trying to think.
Shirtless bears.
I'm trying to think of all the characters I've seen. Oh, there's a red panda. There's a red panda, and if you're okay, so you're leaving this this front for the coyotes, bookie keeping. Like it's like illegal gambling on sports, right? And he's guarding the front entrance. And if you leave and you choose the wrong choice, he'll literally blast you with a shotgun. And he just stands there and laughs. And then the screen goes black and his eyes blink off key, like with one another. And it's the creepiest thing I've ever seen in my life. It's so scary. He doesn't care. He just kills you. There's so many times where I've died as Black Sad because I've made the wrong choice, and it's just like, retry.
I kind of wish next time you play a game like this where dying a lot's an option, just make a tally.
Oh, God.
And then when you come in to talk about the game, it's like, so, while I played this, I died 37 times. And then hand the game off to me and see how many times I die. True story, when I played Heavy Rain the first time, I killed all the heroes and let the villain live by accident. Yeah.
By accident.
No, the second playthrough, though, I did everything in my power to kill the villain to the point where when his story came up, I just put the controller down. I'm like, nah, you're going to get, like, your tar beat in. And it's like, he still survives to the very end, just, like, bleeding and broke. It's like, ah, you made it to the end. I'm like, but you did too.
Did you figure out what's Norman's deal?
Which one was Norman? It's been a while.
The FBI agent.
Oh, yeah. Like I said, second playthrough, I totally just didn't touch the controller for him.
Norman is the FBI agent. He's
Glasses.
Norman Jaden, FBI.
Oh, the glasses guy.
Yes.
I played the mini games with him way too much.
So a lot of people don't know this. The mini games and Ari is actually what's killing Norman.
Yeah, I realize that, you know.
He has this drug called tryptocaine, and if you use the goggles too much, he has to, you know, to get rid of. Because it has to go directly behind his eyes or whatever, anyways. And a lot of people think that it's the tryptocaine that's killing Norman. Unfortunately, it's actually the VR. Like, gets into his brain and it messes him all up and stuff.
Yep. Really played it wrong.
There's not as many like really cool features in Black Sad like this, like with like the Ari and stuff as a detective. But some of the deductions are hard to like get
deduce.
Together. Yeah, some of the deductions are hard to deduce. I'm missing one, and I don't know. Like you pick up two clues, and then like later on you pick up another clue, and that's just how to get to that deduction in general. And I'm like, well, I knew I had to wait a little bit, but I was worried I was gonna miss out on a deduction talking to this athlete over here, and now I have to talk to this guy. It's like,
is the athlete a cheetah?
No, they're a tennis player, and she is
a giraffe.
No, I'm trying to think of what she even is, but she doesn't look like, she looks like a cat, but not. I mean,
that's the best description.
They were really lacking with the ladies on this one. Everybody's a kitty cat. All the girls are kitty cats. I mean, come on. The guy that you're trying to find the murderer for, he's a bobcat.
Why didn't they just make it all cats?
At this point, it just sounds like it's mostly cats.
There's some lizards. There's a couple iguanas.
I mean, cats is taken, so like the alternate title is just mostly cats.
Black Sad.
There's two lizards, chimp.
And a partridge in a pear tree.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm really enjoying it. I haven't finished it yet. There's a weasel. The weasel is great. He works for...
He works right here.
Oh. There's a little weasel, and he's great because he works for the local, like, Tribune, like, the article newspaper, right? So you can actually...
He's a newsie.
Yeah, you can ask him to investigate people by interviewing them and then taking pictures and, like, being all sly and stuff. He's really cool. You get to play as him once in a while. And if you don't time your photos right when you're taking them, like, as him, you can lose the information.
Oh.
And then you have to retry. And it's like, oh, it's so frustrating. But, like, if you get it, you get it. And it's like, I just can't wait to finish this to actually see who done it. Because I have some ideas of who might be the murderer.
I'm saying it's the Rottweiler.
It's not the Rottweiler. It's not the Rottweiler because when he was working... Okay, so the item that was used to murder Bobby, or yeah, the guy that owns the gym. Joe.
The Bobcat's a Bobby.
Joe, the Bobcat. No, his name is not Bobby. Joe Dunn. The person that killed him used one of those arm stretchers, like the springs involved.
I know exactly what you mean, yep.
Yeah, the Bobby Gale, so the Rottweiler, his name is Bobby, he was only up to two springs, but the person that used it to murder him had three springs, so it wasn't Bobby.
Adrenaline.
You could actually deduce that it wasn't Bobby because Bobby's shoes don't match the paint footprints either. That were around when the murder happened.
I don't know, Bobby. That boy ain't right.
Aww.
That boy ain't right.
I don't know. I've been enjoying it so far, but I guess if you would just rather read the story, just go find the comics if you can.
I'm just like imagining one day, like 3 a.m., we just get a message in the group chat of Megan going, it wasn't! Dang it!
I don't know,
I've only ever done that once before where I figured out the quote unquote twist before even seeing anything. M. Night Shyamalan's Devil, a friend of mine tried to get me to see it, and the plot is there's five people in an elevator and one of them is the devil killing everyone else.
Yep.
I pretty much watched the trailer once and I'm like, it's the granny. And he's like, no, that'd be stupid. Oh, yeah. It's not the granny.
Oh yeah,
he comes back, he's like, it was the granny.
I remember that movie. It was actually not bad. I mean, I wouldn't go to theaters to see it, but, I mean, I enjoyed it.
There's a movie coming to theaters soon that I'm going to see.
Oh, what's this one?
Rise of Skywalker comes out.
Oh, Star Wars.
Disney is taking it so seriously, they actually moved up when the next Mandalorian episode is, just so it doesn't conflict with the Rise of Skywalker release. So Mandalorian's kind of going to come out on Wednesday instead, just to get out of Star Wars' way.
Am I the only one here who doesn't care anymore?
Nope. Nope. Don't care.
I'm just so done.
That's how I felt with Revenge of the Sith as well. Then I came out of Revenge of the Sith going, well, it was better than Attack of the Clones.
I mean, this is the last one.
It's not. It is not even close to the last one.
But it's like the last one of this trilogy, and since I've been dragged to the other two, I wanted to walk out of the last one. And I was like, no, maybe it'll get better. Maybe it'll get better. And it never did, and I stayed.
So the difference with this one, though, is it's no longer Rian Johnson who did the last movie. It's J.J. Abrams who did the first of the sequel trilogy. I want to see where J.J. Abrams' story goes.
I want it to be good. I don't want to waste 3 hours of my time again. And then everyone bombarding me with, yeah, did you see it? Yeah, did you see it? It was so good.
Well, go see it.
I have to.
I know.
It's kind of part of your job after working here.
But Kyle, you liked the last...
I like Kylo Ren.
You like Kylo Ren, so okay.
That's the only thing he cares about is Kylo Ren.
Okay,
he's an edgelord.
You don't like The Last Jedi, you like a good Kylo Ren movie.
That's a good Kylo Ren movie.
Well, this is the end of the Kylo Ren movies.
Go see it because Kylo Ren's in it. But
hold on.
So you're not done. You're saying you're done, but you're in fact not done at all.
No, because I have to go see it.
That means you're not done.
I'm done with it, but you have to see Star Wars.
I'm just going
to
go there in the theater. I'm just going to glaze over.
Just when I thought I was out, they pull me back in.
It is. And I'm just... And you know what? I honestly think that a just only Kylo Ren movie would be okay. Like, if it was just right? about Kylo Ren.
Like, the prequel? Like,
all right.
Knights of Ren?
Yeah. Just like,
yeah, the whole movie.
Yeah, that whole movie might, be okay.
That might be this movie.
Hey, did you know that Rey is a Sith Lord?
Hey, Disney.
Maybe.
No, she is.
Kyle, remember what I tell you about Star Wars? I watched the first trailer once. Avoid everything.
Yep. So I live on Reddit.
So for the after stream here, what we're going to do is to describe every trailer in graphic detail to Rob. But we do have to wrap things up, folks. Guys, thank you so much for tuning in. Of course, if you want to continue the conversation online, you can do so on our Facebook page at facebook.com/ThunderGeekSpeak. Our final song here is going to be Weird Al Yankovic with Christmas at Ground Zero. I'm Andrew.
I'm Rob.
I'm Megan.
Okay.
And we're your Thunder Geeks. We'll see you next week.